Welcome, listeners, to Connect the Dots. I'm Alison Rose Levy, here with you every Wednesday at 10 a.m. Eastern Time on the Progressive Radio Network. I'm a longstanding journalist of the environment, food, health, public policy, and the media, coming to you every week with all of the different things in our interconnected and complex world that impact us as individuals, as families, as communities, as regions, as societies, and indeed as a living biosphere, planet Earth. Even though we talk frequently on this show about our individualistic society and the many kind of limiting beliefs and cultural attitudes and structures that divide us, more and more people are connecting, and on this show we connect the dots and bring news and, you know, of the many different interactive things that can bring about the positive changes we seek in our society. On today's show, I'm really delighted to have two guests, and we're going to be talking about changes in economic understanding, structure, and architecture with two terrific innovators who are joining me today. They are Assemblyman, New York State Assemblyman Ron Kim, who is introducing a terrific new initiative into the New York State Legislature that we'll be discussing, and joining him will be a prior guest on our show, frequent guest actually, Robert C. Hockett, an American lawyer, law professor, and policy advocate. And today they're going to be discussing something called inclusive value ledger, which is you know, we think of money as kind of being a given. It's, you know, the way it is, you know, the way it's structured, can't be changed, isn't mutable, has no impacts. You know, it's just kind of like not only the hugest kind of value we have in this very materialistic society, but the way it's structured and used is kind of opaque to us. You know, we just believe it's there. And what we're going to be learning today through this initiative and an article these two gentlemen have collaborated on to discuss that is that, in fact, it can be mutable. It can really work on our behalf in ways that haven't been considered and enacted, but the time is certainly coming here now. So welcome to Connect the Dots, Assemblyman Ron Kim and Robert Hockett.
Thanks, Alison.
Thank you for having
Thanks
me.
Thanks so much. Yeah.
So you just, late last week, actually, published an article in The Prospect. Readers, you can find that online. It's called Dynamic Inclusive Money for a Dynamic Inclusive Economy. And in this proposition that you make in this article, you're saying that we can shift what we value, we can diversify what we support so that we don't have, you know, the huge haves, you know, the limited number of people who are billionaires that Bernie Sanders frequently talks about, and then this huge group of the rest of us who are, you know, somewhere in the have-not range, and some people are very severely deprived by our economic model. So you are planning to introduce into New York State a new value ledger, a peer-to-peer mm-hmm. savings and payment platform mm-hmm. that can, you know, speed up value creation and commerce and improve flow of value so that some people aren't kind of out there hoarding value in offshore accounts and other people are desperately working, you know, triple jobs and you know, and doing real community service and can't make the, you know, can't be compensated or make ends meet. Can you give our listeners, you know, a sense of how this would work?
Sure. Ron, do you want to take first crack at it?
Sure. Well, first, let me just begin by just letting the folks know that Robert Hockett is a genius, and he has been focused on, he brilliantly had been advocating for this and putting together this more or less a blueprint for the community, state, and federal government to own our futures again in a meaningful way and rethink and redesign the way we approach money. I think we have been conditioned for so many decades now to think that we can't do anything about how money's designed. Its core extractive features at every corner, whether we are transacting money from peer to a person to a business, a person to person, whether we are borrowing money from low income to middle class families, everything has been so extractive because of the private sector's control of the payment platforms, the payment architecture. And that's what Bob has brilliantly created. And that's so important why Bob has created this architecture to publicly take over the payment platforms and create the first of its kind state complementary currency off of the public benefits and public taxes, individual credits that we can use as real money and capture value starting today.
I want to say I think it's Ron who's actually the genius, and he's certainly a very quite visionary legislator, and the country would do, I mean, the country would be much better off if we had a lot of Ron Kims out there, but there are very few. But Ron and I have been collaborating on a number of things for a while now, typically very visionary projects that Ron wants to see brought into being here in the state of New York. And then the thought is that if these things work out in New York, they can be models for the country as a whole, sort of in the way that Governor Franklin Roosevelt and State Industrial Commissioner Francis Perkins's New York of the 1920s ended up being sort of the model for what became the National New Deal in the 1930s when Governor Roosevelt became President Roosevelt and State Industrial Commissioner Francis Perkins became Labor Secretary Perkins, the first woman ever in a presidential cabinet. So as Ron said, the idea here is we're thinking that, okay, look, value, there's lots of value that's kind of locked up in any economy, whether it be a local economy, a state economy, or a national economy. And the only thing that enables value to flow, that enables value to kind of spread and be transferred from person to person, is some sort of form that it can be taken, some expression that it can be given that's transferable. We usually call that form through which value is transferred money. But within our national system here in the states, the prerogative to mint or to issue money is reserved to the federal government. State governments and local governments don't have the authority to issue sort of standard type currencies. And that means in turn that if we stick to standard type currencies as the primary carriers or expressors of value, the only way that we can have adequate value expression within certain localities of New York, whether these be upstate New York localities or inner city localities here in New York City or what have you, is by attracting people who have actual dollars to come in. And that usually means bribing them in one way or another, as was attempted to be done with Amazon, for example, not long ago. And happily, Ron led the charge to prevent that from happening, because the way that usually happens, the bribing, we typically call it, abatement. That's the sort of euphemism for a tax abatement. It's really a kind of abasement. It's a sort of a city or a locality kind of abases itself to a large firm, allows it to extract value from the community, and then pay back or pay in only, a tiny fraction of what it extracts in the form of these dollars. So the insight I think that Ron and I had, the thing that struck us is, actually, if you pay attention to one particular feature of money that tends to be ignored or overlooked very oftentimes, namely that money is always relative to a payment system or a payment platform, right? Money is that which counts in payment within a particular payment system, then the way that we can have a kind of state or local money that is not violative of the constitutional prerogative of the federal government to issue the dollar is essentially to create a kind of state or local payment system that allows for the transfer of value, and that value can be denominated in dollars, but allows for the transfer of value from wallet to wallet, so to speak. So what we thought we would do is essentially have the state establish what we're calling a master account. Everybody, every resident of the state of New York, be it a small business or an individual human being, would have a digital wallet that connects up to this master account. Then when the state gives you tax credits for things that you've done, it credits your wallet, and then you can make payments to other people through their wallets simply by directing in the master account for the person you're paying's account to be credited and for yours to be debited. So in a sense, what we're doing is we're creating a payment platform that is itself the bearer of, or the sort of, how should I put it, it manifests a money through allowing, or by allowing, the transfer of credits and debits back and forth between parties. And as Ron has pointed out, and as I'm sure he'll give us, you know, more detail on shortly here, the state of New York typically pays out around 55, 56, I think it's billion dollars, is it, Ron? Or is it million?
Yeah, it's billion.
That's, yeah, with a B, right, in the form of tax credits and various kinds of benefits. And if it were to pay those out, not in the form of, say, paper checks that individual residents have to go and take to some check cashing, quote unquote, service or some payday lender to have cashed at a huge premium that's then extracted by the check casher, if instead the state could directly credit people's wallets with these amounts, first of all, you'd have a lot less of it lost in the form of premium paid out to these check cashers and the like. But you would also have an infrastructure in place through which the state could begin to credit people for other forms of value that they're not credited for at all now, like home care, tutoring of kids after school, helping to clean up or abate the environment when there's environmental difficulties or environmental degradation in a particular area, all sorts of things, right?
Mm-hmm.
So that's the basic idea.
That's pretty amazing. What are those billions of dollars? So basically, in a sense, just to really, you know, make this super simple, but just in the same way that, for example, Medicare for All is taking out a middleman, namely these health insurance industries, that are adding their costs and, you know, sort of subtracting value of what we're actually spending directly on healthcare, you know, and they're pocketing that, and then it's leaving a kind of an inadequacy in what, you know, the people have to use for their health insurance or for their health expenses. In the same way, these intermediaries would be kind of, and are some of them banks, or, you know, are they extracting value? You're saying that they are. And then instead that full value would go directly via this this payment architecture to the people involved, and they could then trade and exchange it with each other. Is that kind of... is that a similar analogy, or?
Yeah, that's a very good analogy, Alison. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Oh, sorry. Go ahead.
Yeah. I would say, like, the middle class families are stuck thinking that credit and credit cards are real money for the past couple of decades, and we're competing to get more credit. It's not real money. These are artificially created money that every time we use credit, these third-party companies are taking a tremendous amount of fee and interest off of us. And for low-income communities, the only way they get access to cash, as Bob had referenced, are at these predatory lenders and check cashing facilities, where they're taking a big cut every time they trade in their checks or the benefit checks. And all these intermediaries, all these middle people they exist to extract money, and what we're proposing would eliminate the need for those type of operators in our economy. But secondly, I think what's also very brilliant about this whole architecture is that we are multiplying the value of each credit. So instead of a tax return that you're getting at the end of the year after you file your taxes, and you get, you know, let's say you get $1,000 for your mortgage or whatever tax return you're getting, most likely you'll be spending that $1,000 online or on one big spurge, or paying down your debts for your student debt or medical debt, whatever debt you have, and that money will be gone. But what we're proposing is that if you're able to actually put those credits in use early on and treat it as real money in our IVL, inclusive value ledger, we are actually increasing the value of the credit itself, multiplying the usage. So even though it's $55 billion now, in reality, if we liquidate $55 billion into real usable, transferable money, we're looking at trillions of dollars of local commerce that will capture the unvalued, undervalued, and devalued work that has traditionally never been counted in our economy.
So yeah. In other words, Ron, there would be a means to compensate these people through this money. In other words, they could now, there could be a decision by people who use their services. There could be the wherewithal and this platform to help compensate people who otherwise would be uncompensated. Is that
Is that the basic point?
Yeah.
That's a big part of it. And what Ron was also saying there is, in effect, you've got an architecture now that allows for the Keynesian multiplier to work in a sort of untrammeled way, right? Mm-hmm. So, you know, you receive a credit from the state, let's say. Let's say it's a tax credit that you receive for, you know, for whatever reason that the state will give a tax credit. That would be immediately available to you via your digital wallet that's hooked up to the state master account. You could then spend some of that locally or, you know, with other folk, you know, on other by making payments to other folk in the region, in the city, in your neighborhood, what have you, simply by transferring it to their wallets. That, of course, puts money in their accounts. Then they can spend more, and then that puts more in other people's wallets. And so you get that kind of infinite concatenation of expenditure that is the secret to the Keynesian multiplier. It's why you can get massive economic growth if you have a higher velocity of exchange, as Keynes or Irving Fisher would have put it. And the thing is, right now, there are all these sort of frictions in the way of that kind of high velocity exchange concatenation of the kind that Ron and I were talking about before, right? So you receive, let's say, if you get your tax credit in the form of a check and you don't have a bank account, and we know that lots of people are unbanked here in the state of New York, here in the city of New York, and of course in the nation at large, you have to go to a check cashing service to do that. That's, of course, one of the most exploitative of all the so-called middlemen, as you refer to them, Alison. They're going to take a gigantic cut out of that. And furthermore, it's going to be, you know, you're going to be slowed down as to how kind of rapidly you can actually use that value. Because first you have to go and get it cashed, right? And so what we're imagining here is you'd have a sort of immediate spendability, immediate exchangeability, and furthermore, no cut would be taken. And furthermore, it wouldn't matter whether you're quote-unquote unbanked, because this would be, in effect, the functional equivalent of banking, public utility banking provided to all residents of the state of New York, too, right? Because your wallet just is a kind of bank account.
Well, that's a huge thing. And then also, mm-hmm. You know, the $100 that you get back and you spend 50 of it, mm-hmm. and, you know, giving it to this person, that person then, as you said, mm-hmm. takes that 25 of that and goes and gets groceries mm-hmm. or whatever. So it's actually mm-hmm. feeding the community multiple
exactly.
times. It's not just like the fixed $50 or whatever it is. It's mm-hmm. actually moving around. And so what you're implying when you talk about flow is mm-hmm. that we have a kind of slowed down, turgid, non-moving mm-hmm. and, you know, unenergetic system.
Mm-hmm.
How does that, you know, create the kinds of economic woes that we're seeing, as well as the, you know, society that we're seeing to have this mm-hmm. slow down system with, you know, people predating on it in their roles mm-hmm. and stuff like that.
Mm-hmm.
In other words, it sounds like it's addressing multiple levels of systemic problems potentially.
Mm-hmm.
Right. And I think it was, Alison, it was designed to function this way, our monetary system mm-hmm. that we're dealing with. It was designed to be slow and reward extractive behavior to foster a hyper cutthroat competitiveness among individuals, mm-hmm. which further leads to us devaluing each other. It actually rewards that kind of behavior, which is why we're seeing such a horrible outcome of human beings and people just treating each other like if we're not humans anymore. You know, how can we mm-hmm. possibly walk past, you know, and have dinner after we see so many homeless people on the corner mm-hmm. suffering every single day? How can we not care? Because we become mm-hmm. so desensitized, and through the economic model, we've started devaluing and judging people and faulting them based on their character, not blaming ourselves of a system that failed to count their worth and values. And that's what we're fundamentally trying to do, shift the mindset back again and treat people like people, like human beings. And if we see another homeless person, we want to get to a point where we blame ourselves. Like, what happened here? Where there's so much value flowing, and how do we not count this person's value? That is the normal way of living. That's how we should be living, instead of just stepping around them and saying, "Well, that person is a bum. He probably didn't work hard enough like we did. I work 5 jobs to get out." You know, that's what people are saying every single day, and that's not the way we should be treating each other, because there is every single person, human being, has value on this planet, and our goal should be to figure out how to count every single one of those people's values.
That's really amazing, because this, I just want to interject briefly for a second, but, you know, Bernie Sanders at the rally here in Queens, the other day, and I'm a Queens native originally.
Saturday.
You know, he asked us all to raise our hands, and he said, raise, you know, for who we wanted to help, raise one hand for yourself and raise one hand for someone else. And when he posed that question, you know, I was like, who's that someone else? And instantly came into my mind a picture of an elderly Asian woman who was a homeless woman that I had seen on the street in the last week, and her face haunted me. And I was like, okay, this is the person, you know, this is the person that I'm raising two hands for. And, you know, in New York, we have the experience of, as you describe, Ron, seeing these people and then having to, you know, have that dilemma of how do we respond and how do we think about it. There may be locales where they don't have to see a homeless person, but with our large population, we do see it. We can't put it out of mind, and I think this whole thing where, you know, we sort of dissociate and put that kind of thing out of mind, as you describe, and blame it on the people, is really a hardening, predating ugliness that nobody who's a caring person wants to have to acknowledge and note that they have adopted. And it also is incredibly unjust and unfair to the people who are falling by the wayside. And this is amazing that, you know, this is a grounds-up way to begin addressing it. Sorry, Bob, I kind of just had to, like, say
that. No, that's fine. No, that's brilliant, Alison. And it also dovetails nicely with something that Ron and I have been especially concerned about over the last couple of weeks, you know, since that terrible incident in Chinatown, right, where several homeless folk were killed at night by somebody who was quite troubled. And one of the gentlemen who was killed was actually an elderly Chinese American who lived in Chinatown. And I couldn't help but be reminded, Alison, as you were just describing the woman that you were describing, the description of that gentleman by one woman who just broke down in hysterical sobs the day after the murders, when she learned that he was among the victims, because she had said that she saw this man every day. Every day they exchanged smiles. She often would give him some sort of a little job to do or something. She'd ask if he could sweep her porch or sweep a stoop or something, and then she'd pay him some money. So there was a kind of an exchange between them, and he always smiled and was very pleasant and sweet. And she said he kind of lit up her day every day. He kind of gave her something back for everything she gave to him. There was a kind of reciprocity in their relation. And she said that she had just been planning that very day, the day after he was murdered, to give him something else. And she was just so horrified. It just broke her right down. And, you know, your reference to the woman that you just mentioned kind of reminded me of that. And Ron and I were both talking about that very gentleman and that very incident just a couple of weeks ago in connection with this very project, and how, in a way, this project is for them. You know, there's a sense in which this project is for them, to sort of enable what amounts to a kind of culture of reciprocity that we have, to find expression also in the local economy that we have, right? Mm-hmm. And so if you have a kind of culture of reciprocity, you ought to have an economy that's reciprocal as well. But all too often, it seems that we have an economy of just mere exploitation or extraction, a kind of one-way street economy, even though we have a kind of two-way street culture.
Wow, so, that's very, very a major insight. That's so... in other words, extraction is, of course, a problem in terms of what we're seeing in the climate, and you know, in the taking of resources, in the lack of democracy in our society. But it's also a fundamental economic flaw that doesn't align with human nature. You know, it's causing climate change, but it doesn't align with our ideas that, you know, we're a kind person, you know, or you know, what we want to be as people, as community members, what we traditionally have been. And this is a way of redirecting that.
It's actually the opposite. Like, it doesn't pay to care. It doesn't pay to be compassionate. It doesn't pay to be empathetic. In fact, like, it pays to be apathetic, and it pays to be cutthroat. It pays to adopt the win-lose mindset, where every handshake is somebody winning and somebody dominating and somebody losing. I mean, that's that's the monetary and economic system that became normalized, where all along money was never intended or envisioned to function this way. Money was always a place where we store and exchange as much value as possible between people. So in many ways, this isn't visionary what we're doing. We're just Bob and I are restoring the original mission. We're actually taking a very conservative definition of wanting what money should be. So it's not actually radical. This is actually a very conservative, you know, way of looking at money.
You know, that's a great point. Yeah, it's like we're returning it to its roots in a way. Another sort of angle on this, that is sort of another way, I think, of saying the same thing, but from a slightly different angle, is if you think about it, if you look at the anthropological literature or the sociological literature, it seems that exchange or reciprocity relations are a kind of cement, a kind of social cement that binds people together and that forms solidaristic communities worldwide. And it seems to have been this way for all of human history, right? And here's the fundamental irony, I think, in our economy now, is that we purport to be an exchange economy, a sort of a reciprocity economy that is kind of continuous with that kind of reciprocity sort of creature that we are. But the irony is that in an exchange economy or a reciprocal economy, the sort of the architecture or the infrastructure through which exchange takes place then would have to be fundamental. It would be foundational, right? Nothing could be more important to an exchange economy than an infrastructure through which exchange takes place. But then if you think about it, who provides our infrastructure of exchange? Well, it's private banking institutions, for one thing, because that's our payment system. Typically, when you make a payment, right, you use a payment card that's attached to some sort of bank account. And so basically, people are making payments to each other out of their bank accounts through a payment system that is constituted by private banking institutions. But this is what's so weird about this, because if we really are an exchange economy, then exchange is the very core of our sort of social grouping, right? And that means in turn that the architecture of exchange ought to be a fundamental public infrastructure, right? It ought to be as foundational and as fundamental and as publicly owned as are the roads, as are the police forces, as are the fire departments, and so forth. And so why is it that we have a private exchange infrastructure or a private, right, transaction architecture, when indeed we claim that the core of our public itself is our sort of reciprocity, our sort of exchange economy? So one way of looking at what Ron and I are trying to do here is we're trying to say, well, look, if we really are an exchange economy, if we really are about the trading of value, then we ought to put our money where our mouth is, so to speak, and have a public infrastructure for exchange, a public payment system, a public payment architecture. And doing that means that you won't have people who are unbanked anymore, and you also won't have people who, you know, even among the banked, are having their payments, in a sense, sort of skimmed off of in the form of fees or interest charges by credit card companies or what have you. All of this should be, you know, again, part of the sort of public furniture, as it were.
Yeah, that makes a lot of sense. You know, I would imagine that some people, you know, because of media influence and corporate influence and media, frequent theme, perennial theme of mine and all of that, and more people are like seeing it everywhere, where, because it is everywhere, and how much it's influenced us. But I can imagine that some people would be like, oh no, the government is going to know what I'm doing and they're going to, you know, have some, you know, kind of involvement in my money. And, you know, without, and while taking for granted you know, the that's, you know, private banking is now doing that, and that for some reason would be different or okay. Could you talk to that point? Because I could see a lot of, you know, fake pushback coming, you know, from that kind of concern.
I mean, the amount of surveillance and data-driven decisions that the private sector is constantly making on consumer behavior. You know, we're at an era where they're predicting behavior. They're not just predicting people's behavior. They're actually modifying people's behavior because we have they have so much data on them. And by us creating the most up-to-date, technologically sound technology, where we're empowering and emboldening the individual to own 100% of their data, and we're sure we can do it because it's the government and it's really openly transparent while we do this without any intent to monetize, extract off of their data, I think it's the only place where people's privacy will be truly guarded in an era of surveillance capitalism.
Wow.
Yeah, I think Ron's exactly right about that, Alison. I mean, it's worth people. It's worth remembering. I think if anybody was going to make that kind of false claim or false charge or raise a false issue, as you put it here, that as Ron said, if you're making your payments through private institutions, as we tend to do now, they have access to all of that data, and as Ron suggested, they typically reap it, they harvest it with a profit motive in mind, and they sell it, they do all sorts of things with it without your permission. And it's partly because they're profit motivated, and it's partly because it's their business model to do that. Whereas if this is a public infrastructure, it's not for profit, and there is no particular business model or incentive to do that. The second thing I think that's maybe worth noting in this connection is that the government could do, if the government were motivated to do that kind of thing, right, to sort of surveil all of your sort of payment data and so forth, it could do that already because, of course, it has regulatory authority over the banks through which you do it now. So, in effect, you know, if you had a malevolent government, that we sort of, I guess we have a malevolent White House at the moment, but anyway, if you had a malevolent government that was, you know, wanting to survey your payments data and the like, you know, if that's what you're worried about, well, you've already got that anyway. So what we really ought to be doing is saying, right. And so what you really ought to be doing, it seems to me, is first of all, take the private sector out of this, because that just adds an additional layer of malevolence and an additional layer of basically, you know, sort of profit motivated surveillance. Take that out. And then, as Ron suggests, make sure that your public sector is indeed transparent and doing the right things with this sort of data. A final point maybe worth noting is that the one way that you escape this kind of surveillance now, and you only partially do because there are limits as to how much of this you can do, but when you make cash transactions, when you engage in cash transactions, there's a kind of anonymity there. But the thing is, the statute that Ron and I have drafted, right, the bill that we've drafted to put this into place, basically allows for and indeed requires a capacity on the part of all participants in the system to cash out as well, right, to be able to make cash withdrawals too. So you'd have the same anonymity advantages that you currently have with cash under the system that we're advocating. And insofar as there's a limit on that, well, that's a limit that's already in place. And that is, you know, anytime you withdraw more than a certain amount of cash from a bank, the bank is required to report that to federal regulators. So, you know, again, nothing's really, we're not adding, in other words, any layers of surveillance. We're only stripping away layers of surveillance by doing what we're doing here.
That's great. What do you see as, you know, you mentioned at the very outset, and the article also mentions some of the, you know, community services, the caring services that people provide to each other that go uncompensated. You know, what do you foresee as, you know, sort of including and deepening that, or, you know, extending it as other kinds of services that the economy, you know, that you can't get done because it's not making a profit for somebody for somebody else, and therefore they judge that not worth doing. What are the other kinds of initiatives and work that people could, you know, could do or, you know, that would come out of this potentially as it proceeds?
Yeah. You know, I think we all know, if we just sit down and just take a moment to reflect, that what adds the most value in our communities are people helping and taking care of other people and people taking care of our environment, our community, and nature. Those are the things that, if you just think about it, as the most value around us. I think we can all accept that, whether you're a conservative, liberal, it doesn't matter. I think people understand why those things are valuable. But for 500 plus years, we've normalized this thinking that anything that involves nurturing or caring is part of, quote unquote, woman's work, reproductive work, and it's a moral obligation for woman to do certain type of work without getting compensated or recognized economically. And that is part of the main reasons why we have an economy that is failing us. And we're not saying we're going to pay you to care, because people already care, and you know they don't want to be motivated through about dangling of money. All we're trying to do is acknowledge the care work that already exists in a monetary form that should be expressed and recognized in our economy.
Mm-hmm. Wow. And the other thing relatedly, Alison, is that, you know, oftentimes the kinds of care work that people provide to one another within families or within communities across families, oftentimes it ends up in the longer term saving the public fisc a great deal of money, right, in the form of lower crime rates, higher education rates, higher earning rates among those who are educated. You know, sort of less in the way of medical expense when people are healthier and happier. All those kinds of things, they can in theory be monetized in the sense that the state fisc basically is spared lots of expenditure over time when that kind of care work is actually bestowed. So in a sense, it's not that difficult to see, right, how the state itself can in effect remunerate or reward things like this. And again, as Ron said, it's not a form of incentivizing, it's rather a form of rewarding, a form of conveying value in return for it, or as a kind of reciprocation of the conveyance of value or the bestowal of value. And it's easy to see how the state can do this in a way that actually in the longer term is saving the state fisc a great deal of expenditure, because as society becomes healthier, there's much less in the way of state expenditure in the form of, again, medical care and emergency vehicles picking people up who are ill or sick, crime fighting expenditures, imprisonment expenditures, all sorts of, you know, basically dysfunction is expensive, if you had to kind of get right down to it. Social dysfunction is expensive. And so what Ron and I are talking about here is basically slowly diminishing the amount of social dysfunction by rendering society itself more functional. And one way to render society itself more functional, of course, is to enable value to flow and enable value to be compensated. And what that means is lower social expense, lower deadweight loss or deadweight cost in the long term. So, you know, this is ultimately going to be highly, highly affordable. A related point, by the way, is getting back to Ron's earlier point about circulation and the rate of circulation. The less that's skimmed off the top, and the more, the greater the velocity of the circulation of value that happens because of what we're doing here, the greater the revenue for the state anyway, right? Because there are these things called sales taxes, right, that go with payments. And so the state draws, of course, a good bit of its revenue in the form of sales taxes. And if you've got a greater velocity of money, if you've got a greater velocity of circulation and value circulating going on, you've also just got greater state revenue too. So it ends up, I think, making the state come ahead fiscally, even as the society that the state is working on behalf of comes out ahead.
You know, I have a background in community theater, you know, from my youth and everything. And we used to tour, you know, performing these various plays and things, and go to all kinds of public settings performing stuff. And one of our sort of classic piece that usually the entire performance was named after our particular piece on the stone soup, which is an old, you know, fairy tale, where the community comes together and the first person puts in a stone, you know, and then other people seeing something being cooked that is going to feed everybody, add, you know, a carrot or this and, you know, whatever they're able to donate. So, and then in the end, everyone eats. So,
yes.
This reminds me of that.
Yeah. I mean, you know, when you get right down to it, I mean, this is something that's easy for people to forget, and I think it's, it makes it all the more important that Ron emphasizes it so often, is that value arises oftentimes out of exchanges themselves, right? Out of, you know, people's conveying value to one another. That is itself often creative of value. So anything that is, you know, sort of enabling more exchange, more reciprocity between people is value enhancing in the long term. It makes for a wealthier society in a much broader sense of the word wealth than just, you know, the way we tend to think of it the way we've been conditioned to think of wealth in our more extractive economy that we have right now.
Mm-hmm. Where is this in terms of the legislature, you know, in terms of support for it? Obviously, this is just beginning. It may be too soon to say, but, you know, do you have any early signs or, you know, idea of how this will be received so that it can be, you know, enacted?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think there will be a learning curve among the lawmaker, my colleagues, as well as the staff in Albany. So we're actually traveling to Albany to sit down with some of the attorneys and policy analysts to do a full briefing of what we envision, what we're trying to create. And we're rolling it out step by step, getting a meeting with lawmakers, different parts of the state to really make them understand what we're trying to do. And we picked up a state senator sponsor already, Julia Salazar, and their staff is 100% on board. They get what we're trying to accomplish, and especially around the care economy and making sure we fix the devaluation of unvalued work. And I think we're in a good spot, especially because the macro level conversation at the federal government is shifting toward about making sure that we capture everyone's values. I mean, the word, the last debate, I don't know how many times the word value was talked about between Bernie and Liz. And I think Andrew was also talking about the caring economy. So it's definitely out there, and people are hearing it. And that's what we're trying to do now through your show and others, just trying to get people to understand that and question what is value, how we judge value, and how come we don't compensate certain type of values. I think that's the starting point. And once we get those conversations going, they're going to wonder, why is it that, you know, me quitting my job and taking care of my elderly parents are not considered valuable to our local economy? You know, like it should be counted for something. I mean, those are the type of discussions we're trying to fuel in the next couple of months.
And, you know, Alison, even for those who are at first maybe unfamiliar with talking about things like value and the exchange of value or the transfer of value or the storage of value, even for people who are, you know, kind of fearful of conversations of that kind, it's very easy to get very, very concrete very quickly by saying, look, why not, if you have trouble thinking along those lines, just think about this instead. Think about how many people do not have access to banking services of any kind, who don't have bank accounts of any kind, and think of all the proposals that have been made about figuring out how to bank the unbanked. Well, this does that right from the get-go, right? I mean, basically everybody immediately has a wallet that is the digital equivalent of a bank account for present purposes. And, you know, even if we can get people to say that's cool, even if they can't understand the value talk, that in a certain sense is all we need, because once you have that infrastructure in place, once you actually have the payment platform in place and everybody has a phone or device accessible digital wallet that connects to this master account, then the matter of the state actually crediting people's wallets for the kinds of care work that they do or the other kinds of valuable things they do, that can come as a matter of course. It could even come later if it takes a while to kind of convince some legislators to do it. Once you have the infrastructure, you have everything you need in place, and then it's just a matter of deciding what you're going to go ahead and compensate and what you're not going to compensate.
Right. That's exactly the core thing. There's the structure, and then there are, you know, the decisions about what you would do. I mean, I don't know. I was thinking about all the people on the subway who are, you know, coming through the cars, and people in New York experience this every day, that we see people, you know, basically begging for food. And, and there's always, you know, one always is responding intuitively, oh, you know, I'll give to this person, and then, you know, but, you know, then you see they were, you know, limping, and now they're running when you see them later on the subway platform. So, you know, you never know, like, you'd like to help, but you don't know what to do. So I could even see this as a vehicle, you know, a decentralized vehicle for, you know, for providing food, you know, rather than, you know, having to make a gut-level decision person by person and you know, and not really knowing what the, you know, like who is really needing the dire help that is being asked for, although one could assume that everybody is, maybe, but nowadays. I mean, it's more and more common. Is there a way this could help in terms of the homeless and sheltering people? And, you know, how would it reach that level?
Yeah. I think it's definitely... Yeah, go ahead.
You wanna, go ahead, Russ. You go ahead.
Yeah, I think the people that are already left behind and have been neglected, that are on the streets, have been completely devalued in our society. They need another level of outreach and and compassion and engagement from our society. Like, where after 2 days after those four homeless folks were killed in Lower Manhattan in Queens. 2 days later, they had a giant civic community board meeting where an army of people were booing at the visual of this tour to homeless people and were yelling and saying that if you build a homeless shelter in my community, I will burn it down. And people were clapping to those comments. I mean, it was a nasty, nasty, just, you know, this combination of misguided folks. And I don't. And our irony is we're all suffering from the same problem. You know, these are middle-class Queens homeowners who are living, and 80% of the people in that room are living paycheck to paycheck with mortgage, credit card debt, and they're just one sickness and one medical bill away from going homeless themselves, you know, some of them. And they're driven by that fear, anxiety, and desperation, and they turn that into... you know, and hatred toward other human beings and unloading the hatred toward others instead of looking at the bigger picture of how do we become more compassionate and empathetic. And that's what we'll fix with our infrastructure, with the architecture, by circulating more wealth and exchanging value. We're allowing people to be more caring so we can avoid this type of confrontations. And when we need to build homeless shelters, we'd be much more compassionate and looking at these folks as humans and not just people who made bad choices because they have character flaws.
Yeah, and a related thing, Alison, in response to your question is I'm going back in my own memory to what sort of got me into money and finance in the first place, as somebody who, you know, never thought he was going to become a financier type, or even a lawyer for that matter, back when I was in my 20s. So, you know, what got me into this in the first place was I was a social worker working with a bunch of homeless guys, and they lived under a bridge, and they had a kind of enterprise going on. They washed cars, detailed cars, and so forth, and they earned a fair amount of money doing this, but they would often complain that they had no way of saving money, right? Their pockets basically were their savings accounts, and these pockets tended to have holes in them, as they said, right? They tended not to be able to save very well. So I started an experiment, which is what ultimately made me go to law school, and it was I had my own apartment, and I'd let the guys sometimes come up to my apartment to shower before job interviews and things like that, because I cut out want ads from the papers and give them to them. And at some point, I got this bright idea to get a magic marker out and write the name of one of my homeless friends on a shoebox that I would have in the closet or something. And so I'd say, you know, you said that you have money in your pocket sometimes, but it tends to kind of burn a hole through your pocket. What if we put some of that money in this box with your name on it, and we'll keep a little ledger in here, basically a little notepad, and we'll just sort of mark deposits, and you'll initial it and I'll initial it when you make a deposit, and then we'll do the same thing with withdrawals if you ever withdraw. And what was interesting is about three of the 12 to 15 guys who were under the bridge, three of them ended up saving a fair bit of money this way in what we started calling the shoebox bank. And they saved enough money basically to, you know, pay union dues and get jobs in an automobile, basically a Ford Motor plant, Ford Motor Company plant nearby. I took that as a great lesson that, you know, what can be done with banking if you make it available to people who previously haven't had it. But it was also, there was a sort of a message in there about what the limits were as well, right? So it's only three guys who saved up a lot that way. Maybe three or four more saved up a little bit, but not a great deal. And then the rest didn't save anything at all. And I think this links up with something that Ron said, and is I think some folk have such troubles that providing some kind of a banking infrastructure alone isn't going to be enough. There's a lot more that we have to do as well, of course. But there are also some for whom the provision of banking services or banking facilities can make a real difference. And these are, you know, the so-called unbanked right now. And one thing I think that Ron's and my initiative here is going to do is it's immediately going to provide a kind of digital shoebox bank, so to speak, to those who can actually use it, who can benefit by it. And again, it's going to do it in a very non-exploitative way because there aren't going to be fees or check cashing charges or extractions of any kind, right? But then there are others whose difficulties go much deeper, partly because they've been homeless for so long and they've been marginalized for so long and been uncared for so long. And obviously what Ron and I are proposing right now is not a panacea for that. It's just part of a much larger picture of a caring economy and a caring society. But, you know, if you think about it, some of those people who this wouldn't help directly, it might help indirectly, because some of those folk might be cared for by others who can now be compensated for doing it. Right. Like the lady who was sobbing hysterically after the murders in Chinatown a couple of weeks ago. She was doing lots of things for the homeless folk in her neighborhood, but she wasn't being compensated for it. She wasn't receiving any kind of official recognition or value recognition for it. And a system like what Ron and I are talking about would facilitate and enable that, too. Right. So even if it doesn't help all of those who need care, by providing something to those who provide care, it will still bring more care to those who are currently uncared for or not adequately cared for, right? So there's a lot that it can do, even if it can't do everything.
Mm. So it begins to actually put down a floor for people to stand on. And so some of the people will be able to stand because of the floor, and they'll be able to then support other people who are having, you know, who are falling through the flooring, so to speak, because of the insufficiencies. And also it, so in a very fundamental way, it really is both helpful, it creates value, and it it kind of reorients the direction of what we can do or what we believe we can do or what we've seen done, so that we are, you know, in a sense, it opens the way to a host of other possibilities, so that we're not in the very untenable position of being, quote-unquote, kind people, you know, who are hardened and tolerating these enormous inequities and kind of, you know, have accepted them as completely normalized. So it's a real reversal of movement in the right direction, as well as having very tangible benefits. Wow, that's, yeah, that's really, really incredible. What do you see as the time frame for all of this potentially unfolding, if all goes well? I mean, any thoughts?
Well, we're preparing now. We're rolling this out to the public in the next couple of months, and we're trying to go into session in January with enough support to get this done and educate our colleagues in the legislature and the governor's office. We're also having independent conversations with other states. For example, I know the Governor Gavin Newsom's office is very much into the caring economy, so we have some surrogates over there that are that have read the op-ed and they're interested in having discussions about moving this forward in California. So we expect other cities and states, once they see Bob's blueprint and our op-eds, and as we roll this out, get more engaged. So we're just preparing to have as many of these discussions, because it might not be New York. New York may take a year or take a couple of years for us to push this type of concept forward. But when we have, when we start having these conversations, in a place like New York, other cities and states are paying attention, and they'll also be looking at this policy in a serious lens.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and relatedly, Alison, when President Sanders takes office in January of 2021, something like this could easily be put into place at the national level by the Treasury Department. Or the Fed, for that matter. The white paper that Ron and I worked on together maps it out, how it can work not only at the local and state level, but also at the federal level. And there are two alternatives, there are two flavors. There's a Fed version and there's a Treasury version. So even if, let's say, New York and California are ahead of the curve relative to the states, and they're getting pretty far along, say, midway through 2020 or something, you can imagine a real leapfrog way ahead where the whole country has it, too, President Sanders is willing to take a look, and we suspect he will be. And we suspect that a President Warren would be willing as well to take a look. We're not sure about the others, maybe, but I think we're both pretty confident that either of those two would, especially Bernie.
Well, then that gives something for listeners to do, in case you had never heard me encourage this before, which, I know everyone has. We have all the more reason, whether, you're a New York State resident or a California resident or anywhere in the country, to assure that our next administration is really ready to tackle and expand this kind of thing. And so you know what to do. Go to BernieSanders.com and volunteer. Thank you so much. I didn't know we were going there, but it's but all roads lead to Rome, so to speak. Thank you so much for being with us and for this fantastic thing. I think that speaking as a woman of a particular generation, I think women have had anxiety about social participation because of the way the strings of wealth are held, and so there's a lot of abdication, and I've been all about empowering women to be involved, and this is really a very important level of empowerment for all people in our society, and so grateful that you have thought this through and that things can be moved in a caring direction on an economic, systemic level. It's fantastic. Thank you so much for being with us today on Connect the Dots, Ron Kim and Robert Hockett. And, we really, this is an ongoing conversation as there are so many facets to this. And listeners, if you've enjoyed the show, please share on social media. This really opens the door to options so that as we kind of change our minds about what is possible, it makes such a huge difference. It's not just about whether we're a nice person or what our beliefs are. It's really knowing that system change can happen and that caring systems can be put into place and that we can all participate in making that happen. Share this so that other people can also be involved, and the show will be available in archive, connectthedots.podbean.com. And we look forward to reading future articles and tracking the evolution of how this initiative moves forward, as well as, how it's built out. Thank you. Thanks to both of you so much for being with us today. And thank you, listeners, for being with us on this edition of Connect the Dots. We'll be back next Wednesday at 10 a.m. Eastern Time on the Progressive Radio Network. I'm Alison Rose Levy. Well, 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 who, well.